Okay, are we on the page where it says outline? We usually don't talk about the ontological argument, but let's talk about that. This is really good. If you guys learn about the ontological argument, basically what it does, it's an argument from the possibility of God's existence to his actuality. And so let's talk about that. Let's talk about the ontological argument. So I like Alvin Plantinga's version. And basically what you do is you're showing that if God is even possible, I think Ramirez was clearing it for me. He was being nice. So let's start talking about the ontological argument. This is great. And then I'm recording this video so you guys will be able to download and stuff. But Plantinga's version is formulated in terms of possible worlds semantics. Now, for those of you that are unfamiliar with the semantics of possible worlds, let me explain that by a possible world, when we say possible worlds, we don't mean a planet or even a universe, but we mean a complete description of reality or a way reality might be. So if I say there is a possible world where Hillary Clinton could have been president, that's true. There could be a possible world. But if I say there's a possible world where Obama's president, that's true. But there is no possible world where you can have a married bachelor, for example. There are some things that are self-contradictory. So when we're talking about possible worlds, this is what we're talking about. So a possible world is a conjunction that comprises every proposition or it's contradictory, so that it yields a complete description of reality. Nothing is left out of such a description. So we're talking about possible worlds, and let's go through the ontological argument. And this is great. Now, for those of you guys that are, talking to atheists and you want to debate with atheists, what you're going to find is they really don't want to give arguments. They don't want to say if God is possible to exist or impossible for God to exist. Once you get them to say that it's possible for God to exist, you know, you've really already won the argument there. They're agnostic. Once they say it's impossible for God to exist, they're making a claim that it's impossible, so they have to give arguments for it. So either way, you win. The trick is getting the atheist to actually converse and give arguments, because they know that atheism is weak, so they're going to try to use evasive tactics. So here's the ontological argument, okay? And we talk about a being that has maximal excellence. I like Plantinga's ontological argument. He conceives of God as a being that is maximally excellent. So when someone says, well, what do you mean by God? You say the most maximally excellent being in the possible world. If there was something more maximally excellent, then that would be God. Now, Plantinga takes maximal excellence to include such properties as omniscience, omnipotence, and moral perfection. A being that has maximal excellence in every possible world would have what Plantinga calls maximal greatness. Now, stick with me, guys. Watch how this jumps out at you. Plantinga argues it is possible that a maximally great being exists. Stick with me here, and if this jumps out at you, you'll get it. You'll say, you know what? You'll get it. It'll pop out at you. It is possible that a maximally great being exists. If it is possible that a maximally great being exists, then a maximally great being exists in some possible world. Remember what we told you about possible world. If a maximally great being exists in some possible world, then it exists in every possible world. And if a maximally great being exists in every possible world, then it exists in the actual world. If a maximally great being exists in the actual world, then a maximally great being exists. Therefore, a maximally great being exists. Now, guys, it might surprise you to learn that steps 2 through 6 of this argument are not controversial, are very uncontroversial, I should say. They're not really controversial. Philosophers, most of them would argue and they would agree that if God's existence is even possible, then he must exist. And when you really think about it, the idea of a maximally great being is intuitively a coherent idea. And so what happens, it seems plausible that such a being could exist. So in order for the ontological argument to fail, this is the burden that the atheist has. The concept of a maximally great being must be incoherent. So this burden goes on the proof of the atheist. Like I mentioned earlier, like the concept of a married bachelor. So let's get started. And what we'll do is we're going to go through, let me pick out some really good ones here. Okay. Now, let me talk to ZX7R on this. So ZX7R, because you're a fellow motorcycle bike rider. Now, ZX7R, are you a Christian, or are you an agnostic, or are you an atheist? And I appreciate you kind of chatting with me, man, because I want to show you something as we go through this. ZX7R likes the so you're an agnostic? Okay. Well, when you're an agnostic, that's pretty easy because the person's in a state of they're not willing to commit one way or the other. So agnostics are, I know you're not wanting to debate, but agnostics are pretty easy to defeat and debate because it's tough. They're coming from a position of they don't want to say it's impossible for God to exist or it's possible for God to exist, you see? So they don't want to say that, you know? Yeah, Peter H., you know, I would love if the amazing atheist would come in here and debate me. I've challenged him to a debate, but he said something like there's a sale on bananas at the supermarket. I don't know what that means, but I've challenged him to debate, and I'd love to debate the Thunderfoot also. But the thing is, they don't have any arguments. And a ZX7R, a fellow motorcycle rider, you know, I used to be an atheist. But there really are no good arguments of why we should believe atheism is true. So when I was an atheist, I wanted proof and evidence. I don't see any proof and evidence that atheism is accurate and correct. So I left atheism, because the lack of proof and evidence. So what we go through, the first thing we go through is the universe had a beginning. Do you guys know that it used to be thought that the universe was just eternal and uncaused, but now science has really vindicated the Christian theist, and it's pretty well known that the universe had a beginning. I mean, if someone wants to be, you know, respected and they don't want to seem like a kook, you know, in the scientific community, you really got to say that, you know, the universe had a beginning. Even Stephen Hawking says, you know, the universe had a beginning. But do you know also the Borg-Guth-Vilenkin theorem? These guys are absolutely brilliant. They said that any universe that is in the process of expansion must have had a beginning. Even if someone wants to posit multiverse or, you know, oscillating universe, steady state universe. So the argument goes like this: whatever begins to exist has a cause. Now, let's stop at argument one. It doesn't say whatever exists has a cause. What's the key phrase there, guys? Whatever begins to exist has a cause. I will, J3. I'm recording right now, man. Like 2 hours. Or I'll do an hour and a half. We'll do an hour and a half. So, for example, numbers exist. Many people believe that all right, that sounds good. Sorry, guys, I'm getting instant messages here. So whatever begins to exist has a cause. The universe began to exist, therefore it has a cause. Well, the cause can't be energy, and it can't be matter, because energy and matter are not eternal. I got to tell you guys something. You've got to go to shotgunnow.net. I'll put the link below this video and click music podcast And listen to Lawrence Krauss. I think Lawrence Krauss gives science a bad name. He refers to, he says nothing is headed towards us and you know, it's going to destroy us all. But what's he talking about? He's talking about the Andromeda Galaxy. The Andromeda Galaxy isn't nothing. What Lawrence Krauss is doing now, and it's kind of sad, it's pathetic in a way, is he's dishonestly changing the word nothing to mean energy or this vacuum state in the universe, you know, and he calls it nothing. Well, it is something. Nothing doesn't have any power. It doesn't have any property. So when he says nothing's coming to get us and it's going to destroy us all, nothing couldn't do that because nothing is the lack of anything. So you've got to hear it. It's hilarious. They made a little comedy audio out of it with circus music and stuff where he's like saying nothing is something, but something is nothing. And it's like who's on first? It's absolutely hilarious. So nothing, ZX7, nothing is the lack of anything. So let's say ZX7 went to a gas station and he wanted gas in his motorcycle because he's running low, and the gas station attendant said, how much gas do you want? And he said, nothing. Is the gas station attendant going to give him any gas? No, because nothing means there isn't anything. So another problem for atheists is there was no matter that was pre-existing. There was no energy. Anthony Kinney of Oxford University, he says, hey, look, if someone's an atheist, they must believe that the universe came from nothing and by nothing. So this is why you have really dishonest, you know, atheists like Krauss saying that he talks about nothing, but when you actually look what he's talking about energy. So it's really dishonest. You gotta listen to it. Go below this video, shotgunowl.net, and you could actually listen to it. It's like a joke. It's like he makes science look bad. You know that he would try to change the word nothing. But here's what's really interesting too is the fine-tuned argument. I've talked to atheists, and I've listened to like the major atheist debates, and they'll say this is one of the toughest arguments. They hate it. It's like nails on a chalkboard to them. I believe what was that one guy's name? It'll come to me while I'm doing this. Bart Ehrman. There, I just Bart Ehrman. He said that this argument here is pretty tough to overcome. And so let's talk about the argument that Bart Ehrman even has a tough time with, the fine-tuned argument. And when we're talking about the fine-tuning, this is known as the teleological argument. So what did we just cover? We covered the beginning of the universe. Even Stephen Hawking said that the universe had a beginning. We know that PCW Davies talks about the fine-tuning, so we'll mention him. But God makes sense of the complex order in the universe. There's complex order in the universe. During the last 30 years, scientists have been shocked to discover that the existence of intelligent life does depend upon a delicate and complex balance of initial conditions. Now, this is another reason why I left atheism. Atheism was so irrational, it was stupidity in its purest form. I'm supposed to believe when I was an atheist that what I'm about to tell you was all due to dumb luck or chance. But it can't be, guys, because we know that life prohibiting universes are vastly more probable than any life permitting universe. So we got life prohibiting universes all over the place. You know, we don't have them mathematically where we have life permitting universes all over the place. We know that life prohibiting universes are vastly more probable. How much more probable? Well, the answer is that the chances that the universe should be life permitting, get this, guys, this is why so many people leave atheism, are so infinitesimal as to be incomprehensible and incalculable. Stephen Hawking, for example, has estimated that if the rate of the universe's expansion just 1 second after the creation of the universe, just 1 second, if it would have been smaller by one part, get this, in 100,000,000,000,000, the universe would have re-collapsed into a hot fireball, extremely fine-tuned. I can't believe that all this is due to dumb luck or chance, but there's not just one of these constants that are fine-tuned, or five, or ten. Even that would be just amazing. You'd have to reject chance then. Nope, we got about 50 of them. So chance is off the table. There's only three reasons for this remarkable fine-tuning: either dumb luck or chance, physical necessity, like something in natural law, or design. Get this, guys. PCW Davies has calculated that the odds against the initial conditions being suitable for star formation, and you guys know the planets, you know, couldn't even exist without that, is the number one, followed by 1,000,000,000,000,000 zeros at least. So it can't be due to dumb luck or chance. Just the fine tuning's amazing. Now, he also estimates that a change in the strength of gravity or of the weak force by only one part in 10 raised to the 100th power would have also prevented a life-permitting universe. Okay. When you go to shockonow.net, www.shockonow.net, click links, L-I-N-K-S, and you'll see the list of the life-permitting constants. Also click podcast area, and you'll hear Krauss saying, well, nothing is something, but something is nothing, and nothing is something. It's so stupid. You'll hear it there. I got the actual audio of him saying it. So let's get back to what we were saying here. There's about 50 such constants and quantities present which must be fine-tuned in this way if the universe is to permit life, you know, at the creation of the universe. They were present. But here's what's amazing. It's not just that each quantity must be fine-tuned, guys. Even their ratios to each other must also be exquisitely fine-tuned. So what happens here is no rational, honest person, and I know you guys are rational and honest, no rational, honest person could say, oh, well, we just got lucky. That's not the way rational people think. Look, you get a probability multiplied by a probability by improbability until you really can't look at yourself in the mirror and say, well, we just got lucky. Your mind will be reeling in incomprehensible numbers. Well, what about something in natural law? Well, it's not due to natural law either. There's no physical reason at all why these constants and quantities should possess the values they do. PCW Davies was a one-time agnostic physicist. But here's what he says. Through my scientific work, I have come to believe more and more strongly that the physical universe is put together with an ingenuity so astonishing that I cannot accept it merely as a brute fact. Likewise, Fred Hoyle says, look, a common sense, and this is what we're talking about, guys, here, common sense, interpretation of the facts suggests that a super intellect has monkeyed with physics. I can go on and on. The proof and evidence is overwhelming for design. Look at Robert Jastrow said. Robert Jastrow is the head of NASA, NASA's Goddard Institute for Space Studies. Robert Jastrow, the head of NASA's Goddard Institute for Space Studies, what I just read to you here, he calls this the most powerful evidence for the existence of God ever to come out of science. So once again, we've got three reasons for the fine-tuning: either dumb luck or chance. Well, we throw that out the window. That'd be ridiculous to say that. No rational person would say that. Well, we also got physical necessity or design. Well, there's nothing there's no physical reason. There's nothing in natural law that shows that those constants and quantities should be that way. Throw that out. It follows rationally that the more plausible reason for this fine-tuning is obviously designed. So once again, the view that the Christian theists have always held, that there is an intelligent designer of the universe, obviously, I'm sure you guys would agree, makes much more sense than the atheistic interpretation, which, let me see if I can say this with a straight face without laughing, that the atheistic interpretation that the universe, well, it just popped into being uncaused out of nothing, and it also just happened to be fine-tuned for intelligent life with an incomprehensible precision and delicacy. Right. You tell that to your little kid, they wouldn't believe you. Can you see why so many people leave atheism, guys? It is madness in its purest form. Go where the proof and evidence leads. Now, let's mosey on down to objective moral values. Now, I like the argument we just went through, the fine-tuning. I like that one the best because that really, when I found out about that, I'm like, wow, I mean, who could deny that reeks of intelligent design, right? But believe it or not, the one that I'm going to show you now is the one that seems to be more effective with people saying, yeah, you know what, this is a pretty strong argument. But let's wrap up the intelligent design and we'll go to objective moral values. The fine-tuning is necessary for us to have life. It's necessary for the universe. It does suggest an intelligent designer. Random chance is an inadequate explanation for intelligent life. Out of all the arguments, if you're a Christian in the room here, out of all the arguments, this is the one that seems to be the most powerful. It's not my favorite one because it just seems so obvious to me. I really like the fine-tuning argument because a lot of people don't know about it. But this one, I think that's why this one is so powerful, because it is so obvious, because this is something that all of us in our lives, we deal with objective moral values every single day. So I think that's why it's so, you know, powerful. God makes sense of objective moral values in the world. If atheism was true, we wouldn't see objective moral values in the world, but we see it. We see objective moral values. And if God does not exist, then objective moral values do not exist. And believe it or not, most theists and atheists agree on this point, that if God does not exist, then objective moral values do not exist. For example, J.L. Mackey, he's since passed away, but J.L. Mackey of Oxford University, he was a very influential atheist. Here's what he said. He admitted it. He said, quote, if there are objective values, they make the existence of God more probable than it would have been without them. So we have a defensible argument from morality to the existence of God. But in order to avoid God's existence, what you'll see atheists do, and Mackey did the same thing, is he denies that objective moral values exist. Here's what he said. He said, and I quote him again, it is easy to explain this moral sense as a natural product of biological and social evolution. He thinks it comes from evolution. Now, Michael Ruse also, he's a philosopher of science. He agrees with that dude. And he says, look, morality is just a biological adaptation. It's no different than our hands and our feet and our teeth. So Michael Ruse is trying to say that morality is just due to biological adaptation. And then he even says this. He quotes Jesus here, which is interesting. Here's what he says. He says, look, I appreciate that when somebody says, love thy neighbor as thyself, they think they're referring above and beyond themselves. Nevertheless, such reference is truly without foundation. Morality is just an aid to survival and reproduction, and any deeper meaning is illusory. So these are atheists, and they're saying that morality is just an illusion. Friedrich Nietzsche, the great atheist of the last century, guys, you know, he's the guy that who proclaimed the death of God. He understood that the death of God meant the destruction of all meaning and value in life. And I think we would agree that he's right. If we take God out of our lives, the death of God would mean the destruction of all meaning and value in life. But we got to be careful here. this is one thing that a lot of people always confuse. We're not saying you have to worship God in order to realize that objective values exist. Everyone in here, whether you're atheist, agnostic, Wiccan, pagan, vegetarian, meat eater, whatever, everyone in here knows that murder is wrong, that rape is wrong. And even though some of you in here don't worship God, you know this. This is objective morality. Well, where does this objective morality come from? It certainly can't come from atheism, because on atheism, we're just animals. And those type of things, murder and rape, happen in the animal kingdom all the time, right? So we're not saying that you have to worship God in order to recognize that objective moral values exist. I think we all do. Rather, here's the question. If God does not exist, do objective moral values exist? Think about it. Like Mackey and Ruse, I can't see any reason to think that in the absence of God, morality that has evolved by Homo sapiens just through evolution is objective. After all, couldn't it have evolved differently? And if there is no God, then what's so special about human beings? Isn't it true that atheists believe they're just accidental byproducts of nature, which have, you know, evolved relatively recently on a speck of dust lost somewhere in a hostile and mindless universe, and they're doomed to perish individually and collectively in a relatively short time? See, on the atheistic view, this is the madness of atheism. On an atheistic view, some actions, say rape, may not be socially advantageous. This is the atheistic view. And so in the course of human development, that's why it's, you know, it has become taboo. But the evil of atheism is that does nothing at all, absolutely nothing, to prove that rape is really wrong. On the atheistic view, there's nothing really wrong with your raping someone. That's how evil atheism is. Thus, without God, there is no absolute right and wrong which imposes itself on our conscience. On atheism, who or what makes this morality objective? But the problem is in the real world that you guys live in and I live in, objective moral values do exist. We all know it. Deep down, we all know it. Objective moral values do exist. And there's no more reason to deny the objective reality of moral values than the objective reality of the physical world. Actions like rape, torture, child abuse, they're not just subjective behavior. They're evil, guys. Some things, at least, are really evil. Likewise, love, equality, and self-sacrifice are really good. But this is the problem. If objective values cannot exist without God, and it's clear that objective values do exist, then it follows logically and inescapably that God exists. Let me stop here. I'm going to put an annotation on this video, I'll put the link below this video I'm doing. I was in a debate with an atheist, and then during the debate, he backslid into being an agnostic. And then I asked him this question. I said, is rape always wrong objectively, or is it good in some instances? And I knew on live radio he wasn't going to say, well, it's subjective. It's good in some instances. So he kind of evaded the question. You know how atheists love to evade questions. But I stuck with him, and I said, no, you know, don't evade. Is it objectively wrong, or is it good in some instances? And he said, well, it's subjective, which means that it's not objectively wrong. That means it could be good on his atheistic view. But see, I was ready for him. I said, well, then give me an example when it would be good and it wouldn't be objectively wrong. Now, if he says that on the radio, he's just going to look like a complete nut job, right? Because it's not normal to say that rape is subjective. Only a nut would say that. So he says, okay, it's never. So he conceded objective moral values, and you can hear that we did that debate on TCP radio. I'll put the actual debate. Actually, you can hear the whole debate at shotgunhow.net in our debate section, and I'll also put it below this video in the video description. If you believe, like me, that rape is always wrong in all instances, then you believe in objective moral values. If God does not exist, guys, objective moral values do not exist. Objective moral values do exist. Therefore, it follows inescapably that God exists. So let's go to Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. All righty, we're on the well-established facts page, right? Now, some folks might think that the resurrection of Jesus is just something you believe in by faith or not. And I certainly have no problem with folks that believe in this based on faith. But in fact, there are three established facts that are actually recognized by the majority of New Testament historians today, which I believe support the resurrection of Jesus. And I'm going to show you how it's rational for someone to be a Christian. It is irrational to be an atheist. See, on the atheist view, you have to believe that you're just a product of being an accident, and there is no objective purpose to an atheist life. But on the Christian view, there is an objective purpose, and we don't believe that we're here just by accidents, and we do believe, obviously, in objective moral values. But some folks might think that the resurrection of Jesus is something you believe in by faith only or not. But in fact, let's go through three established facts that are recognized by the majority of New Testament historians. And I believe they support the resurrection of Jesus: the empty tomb, Jesus' post-mortem appearances, that's after his death, and the origin of the disciples' belief in his resurrection. No one here would disagree that the disciples really believed that Jesus rose from the dead. So we have to ask ourselves, well, where did they get this belief? Even Garth Ludemann, he's a very skeptical German New Testament critic, even he admits that the disciples did believe that Jesus rose from the dead. So a rational person would say, well, why would they believe in this? So let's go through that. Fact one, on the Sunday following his crucifixion, Jesus' tomb was found empty by a group of his women followers. Now, let's stop there for a second. If Viva Ramirez and Jordan and I were all Christians and we were going to concoct a lie that Jesus rose from the dead, well, first of all, we're Christians, we wouldn't do that anyways, but let's just use the skeptical argument that we're going to lie and say, you know, Jesus rose from the dead, and we wouldn't have the story showing women at the tomb, because women's testimony was not really regarded back then. Then why would they show women at the tomb? Well, the fact is the men were cowards. So what you want to look for when you're studying things is the level of embarrassment. And what the disciples do is they were honest, and they had told the story the way that it really was. The fact of why the women were at the tomb can best be explained that they were the ones that were at the tomb. And the disciples faithfully recorded this, what for them must have been an embarrassing incident, that they were scared. So on the Sunday following his crucifixion, we know Jesus' tomb was found by a group of his women followers. Jakob Kramer, he's an Austrian scholar who is specialized in the study of the resurrection. He knows more about this than all of us combined, right? He said, quote, "By far, most scholars hold firmly to the reliability of the biblical statements about the empty tomb." And there's another New Testament critic, and this guy's a critic of the New Testament, D.H. Van Dalen. Here's what he says, quote, "It is extremely difficult to object to the empty tomb," get this, guys, "on historical grounds." Notice, on historical grounds, not spiritual, philosophical ground. He says, he continues, "Those who deny it do so on the basis of philosophical or theological assumptions." Fact two, on separate occasions, different individuals and groups saw appearances of Jesus alive after his death. There's a very prominent skeptical, this guy's not like pro, you know, Christian or pro Jesus Christ, but he's a skeptical German New Testament critic, Garth Ludemann. Here's what he said, and this guy's an atheist. He said, quote, "It may be taken as historically certain that the disciples had experiences after Jesus' death in which Jesus appeared to them as the risen Christ." And I'll go through some of the other, what the other side says about this, like objections to it. He says, they say these appearances were witnessed not only by believers, but also by unbelievers, skeptics, and even enemies. What some folks will say, because they can't argue that the disciples really believed that they saw Jesus Christ. No one disputes that. Even Garth Ludiman, he's an atheist. No one disputes that the disciples believed that they saw it. So we have to come up with, well, what did they see then? Well, Garth Ludiman says, well, maybe they could have saw a hallucination. But if you talk to medical doctors, and if you go to shotgunnow.net, Lee Strobel talks about this, how he met with a doctor, and the doctor said that would be more of a miracle than anything if they all saw this hallucination, because he said the hallucination comes from your own mind. But the Jews had no preconceived idea of a dying, much less rising Messiah, so they wouldn't see Jesus in the flesh there standing in front of them. They probably would have pictured him at the spiritual place, you know, at Abraham's bosom, or, you know, in the clouds or something like that if they were having a hallucination. Why would they have this very non-traditional, non-Jewish vision in the clouds when they're not having a hallucination? They actually see him physically. Here's another thing, too. Why would the disciples say they saw him physically? Why couldn't they have just said, if it was a lie, why not take the easy route and just say, oh, yeah, we saw him spiritually or something? Why physically? Now, it just, everything's pointing to that Jesus did rise from the dead. I can't see any naturalistic, rational reason for this. Now, fact three, the original disciples suddenly came to believe in the resurrection of Jesus, despite having every predisposition to the contrary. Now, we talked about this. If they were going to have hallucinations, where does the hallucination come from? Well, the skeptic would say it comes from the person's own mind, but you could only hallucinate what's in your mind. So they would probably hallucinate Jesus, like I said, at the spiritual place of Abraham's bosom or something like that. They wouldn't hallucinate him standing right there in front of him resurrected. That was not a Jewish belief. And this is why the original disciples, when they came to believe in the resurrection of Jesus, it doesn't make sense that it would be fraud, because they didn't have any predisposition. They had, to the contrary, they didn't believe it in a dying or rising Messiah. And even the Jewish beliefs about the afterlife precluded anyone's rising from the dead. It didn't allow it prior to the end of the world. Now, another New Testament scholar that has studied this, Luke Johnson, he's at Emory University. Here's what he says. He looked at it too, and he's come to the same conclusion that, you know, the majority of people that I know have come to. He says some sort of powerful transformative experience is required to generate the sort of movement earliest Christianity was. And N.T. Wright, this guy's brilliant. He's a British scholar, very well known. He said, quote, "That is why, as a historian, I cannot explain the rise of early Christianity unless Jesus rose again, leaving an empty tomb behind him." And I believe it. I don't doubt one millimeter in my mind. I don't doubt it. I believe he has been risen. So it seems to me that the Christian is justified in believing that Jesus rose from the dead and was who he claimed to be. But that also entails that God exists. Now, let's mosey on down to the last page here. So we went through the established facts concerning Jesus. The hypothesis God raised Jesus from the dead is the best explanation of these facts. Now, if you're an atheist, you need to come to the fact that, okay, God does exist, you know, you admit that, and then it follows nicely. And if you already believe that God exists, and you admit that God exists, because I do believe that atheists do believe God exists, but I mean, if they're willing to acknowledge God exists, let's say it like that, then all you need to come to believe in is that Jesus rose from the dead, that God raised Jesus up. Now, no Christian believes that Jesus rose naturally. No Christian believes that. We believe that he rose supernaturally. Now, what I don't understand is if the atheist evolutionist can believe that a worm was in the slime and then lightning struck it, and then all of a sudden a little tumor grew on its forehead and then an eyeball came out, and then the worm crawled up on the water, and lo and behold, there was another worm there, and they mated and they had kids, and then they evolved into primates, and then this complex eye grew on them, and they had arms, and then all this evolution stuff. I mean, it takes more faith to believe in that. It's easier for me to believe in the resurrection than it is to believe in that. And we don't even have these transitional fossils. Where are they? So I'd rather believe in Christianity based on evidence than on evolution and atheism based on lack of evidence. And guys, listen, you atheists, you don't have any evidence. Your atheism lacks evidence. You know, Dr. William Lane Craig said it best. He said, the atheist, let me let this page turn. He said, the atheist is believing in a view of which there is no evidence. Guys, it's not the Christian that is living his Christian life based on blind faith. We have faith in the evidence. My atheist friends, listen closely. You have faith in nothing. You have no evidence. Do what I did. Get two things. Get a brain. Get a heart. Leave the madness of atheism. It all boils down to two things, guys, when you really think about it. On atheism, there is no objective purpose to life. I remember when I was an atheist, a lot of things didn't make sense to me. I'm like, well, what's the point of living if there's no purpose to life? You just wake up, on atheism, you're just an animal. You're here to be born, and then just to exist, and then to die. You know, you got people like Richard Dawkins, who used to be an atheist, now he's an agnostic. And here's what the agnostic Richard Dawkins said. He said, there's no such thing as good. There's no such thing as evil. There's no purpose to life. There's nothing but blind, pitiless indifference. Is that the best that you got to offer us, atheism? Really? That's horrible. I like what Jesus Christ offers. I have an objective purpose to my life, and I have truth. I have truth. I have a worldview that actually gives me an objective purpose to life, and I have a worldview where I can say, hey, you know what? I'm not just living on this life and existing. You know, this life is just a cramped foyer that's going to open up into eternity. And so it all makes sense to me now. Another thing too, I got a couple of questions too. I'm just kind of chatting. Oh, hey, Wiki. Just kind of chatting. Have you guys ever noticed that atheists never bash Satan? Have you guys noticed that? You know why? It's not polite to bash your father. And that was another thing when I was an atheist. I mean, I wasn't like a militant type, you know, atheist. But a lot of my friends, they would go around bashing God, and they would never bash Satan. And I was thinking, I go, you know, there's something to that. Another thing, too, that doesn't – this is going to be the comedy part of this video, okay? Here's another thing that doesn't make sense to me. I'll ask atheists, I'll say, wait a minute. I go, where do you believe you – because they're trying to get me to be an atheist. Shaw, come on, you should be an atheist, you know. And so, and I go, well, why? I want to have an objective purpose to my life, you know. I don't want to – you know, I don't want to be like you, you know, no offense. I don't want to be like Richard Dawkins, agnostic Richard Dawkins. I don't want to be like, you know, how Christopher Hitchens was. I don't want to be like, you know, Sam Harris. I'd rather be like, you know, Jesus Christ or the disciples. You know, that's those are people I can respect. I can't respect Richard Dawkins. You know, Richard Dawkins, they went back in his family tree, and I kid you not, they found out that he, in his family tree, his relatives were slave masters. Well, I think Richard Dawkins has some of those genes and the DNA still in him because he's trying to turn you guys into slaves. You know, atheism is just slavery. You know what Jesus said? He said, those who have sinned are slaves to their sin. I was a slave to my sin. I was an atheist. But I like when Jesus says, but whom the Son of Man sets free is free indeed. Don't listen to the slave masters like agnostic Richard Dawkins, because all they're going to do is they're going to forge the ball and chain of atheism around your ankle, and it's just going to bring you down. Yeah, Chris, we'll talk in a moment, man. I'm kind of recording here. Here's what doesn't make sense to me. It's okay, Chris. No problem, man. You're allowed to chat and stuff. So I'll ask my atheist friends. This doesn't make sense. Just hear me out on this, guys. I think about this a lot. I'll ask my atheist friends, and a lot of them come in the room here, and I'll say, why are you trying to be such an evangelical atheist? Why are you such an evangelical atheist? They're so religious with their atheism. They'll even create shows, TV shows, all about atheism, even though they'll admit there's no purpose to their life, objectively. So I don't get it. I go, why are you such an evangelical atheist? And I go, don't you believe that when we die, we just go into the dirt, right? I mean, that's what you say. And they go, yeah. And I go, well, then it doesn't make any difference whether I'm an atheist or not. If atheism was true, isn't it true that I, as a Christian, if atheism's true, I just go into the dirt when I die just like you? And they'll say, well, yep. And I said, well, then you don't even need to talk to me about your atheism then. Now, they can't say, well, no, because we want to change the world. You know, we want to change the political. No, you don't. You're not going to change anything, my atheist friends. You're not going to change a darn thing. You know why? Remember what Christopher Hitchens said? He said it doesn't matter. He said the Andromeda galaxy is coming closer and closer. It's going to kill us all. So the atheist that acts like they're changing something in the world, they're just like the man who foolishly is rearranging chairs on the Titanic. The atheist that acts like atheism is the solution is like Wile E. Coyote putting roller skates on his feet and a rocket on his back and lighting the rocket, and he flies off and plummets down into the ravine. The atheist that thinks he's going to accomplish something and change lives or better humanity, no, he's not going to do it. Because on atheism, remember, everything leads to death. Richard Dawkins said there's no purpose, no good or evil. You're just machines to propagate DNA. So on atheism, the best thing that you could do if you want to be true to your convictions is to remain silent because there is no purpose. Yeah, Chris is typing something in the chat. He's absolutely right. He says, look, it's ultimately pointless to do anything because nothing will be remembered. That's exactly right. Chris, you hit a grand slam home run with that one. The atheist is like the man sitting on a tree limb, sawing it off while he sits on it and he realizes he's falling down. The atheist is like the boxer in the boxing ring who he goes to give a strong right hook and he punches himself in the face and knocks himself out. Atheism is madness. I'm on a roll, guys. Let me just go through some of the comedy here. Do you know that the Atheist Experience Show was asked to provide proof and evidence that atheism is accurate and correct? And are you ready for their philosophical answer? Are you ready for their supposed intelligent response? You ready? They believe atheism is accurate and correct, they said, because a unicorn in a box. This is the madness of atheism, folks. So, Chris, I think I figured out, though, why atheists are such evangelical atheists. I figured it out. The only reason why an atheist would ever open up his mouth and try to convince you to be an atheist, get closer, guys, to the speaker. Get closer. I want you to hear this. The only reason why they would ever do it, because Chris is right, it's ultimately pointless. So why even go ahead and try to get someone to be an atheist? You know why, guys? I'm going to tell you a secret. I'm going to tell you. It's because they don't believe it. They don't believe it themselves. The atheists don't believe it themselves. They know it's a bunch of crap. It's a bunch of crap. So the next time someone the next time, let's end this video. The next time, and they're saying yes in the chat. The next time an atheist comes up and starts talking about their atheism, say, so you don't believe what you're saying. Because it don't make any sense to be an evangelical atheist. Now, I'm asking, are there any atheists in the room that want to give us some proof and I want to ask the question. This is the question we always challenge people. Give us some proof and evidence that atheism is accurate and correct. Just one argument. Does any atheist want to try it? Even just one. Let me swing back to the chat. Okay, are there any atheists that want to give us a good argument why atheism is accurate and correct? You could even get on the mic. You know, I have to tell you guys, I looked out my window right now, and there's a coal miner out there, old coal miner with the gray beard, and he's got like a mule. And there's like a tumbleweed blowing by. So, and he's like, Shock, just move it right along. They don't have no proof and evidence. Okay, Hey Guys wanted, you wanted the site that I said, Hey Guys? So I want you guys to know, we asked, and no atheists have any proof and evidence. Okay, what you do is you go to... What part did you want of the site? Because I talked about a couple things. But you go here, click podcast, and you could, if you want to die laughing here, you can hear Lawrence Krauss talking about nothing and how nothing is something, but something is nothing, and he's going back and forth. It's hilarious. That's the top one on that page. Now, you also want to go there and click links. And then there's the list of the life-permitting constants. Yeah, so ZX7, you say you're an agnostic or atheist, right, my friend? So let me ask you something. If someone asks you, well, you know, Shock left atheism because the lack of proof and evidence, what would you say? Oh, okay, man. No problem. So you're open-minded. I respect that. Well, you're a motorcycle rider, so you're obviously a highly intelligent individual with superior breeding.